Ja, herzlich willkommen zu einer neuen Ausgabe SI Talk und als erstes einmal Konflikt of Interest. Ich bin Aktionär, habe ich nämlich gestern bei einer Aktie auch vergessen, aber diesmal nicht. Ganz spannende Aktie, ich bin ein starker Gläubiger dieser Aktie und ich hoffe, dass die dementsprechend auch so weiter performt. Also was die Operatives ist, weil mit der Aktienperformance bin ich noch nicht hundertprozentig glücklich. Brenton, thank you to have time. I say this in my German introduction. I'm a shareholder, so I have a conflict of interest.
Fair enough.
I'm really happy with the operating performance.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not 100% happy with the share performance. They can be a little bit better. I think this is natural. But the most important thing is that the operational is working well.
Correct.
Interesting for me is nearly every week, every 2-3 weeks, you're coming out with a new contract.
Mm-hmm.
I saw one that they bought now the third component from you. Mm-hmm. A company,
mm-hmm.
So that's mean really they are strong believers in the product and
more so than believers, they're actually getting commercial results themselves, right?
So, and this is I think the best proof of concept what you can have, that your product is really what the people think. Also, you're coming up with a deal in the cannabis space,
mm-hmm.
You have a deal with Tilray and now with Teagot. Green Organic. I'm shareholder too, from Green Organic Attachment. So,
mm-hmm.
By the way, not a conflict of interest. So it's looking really great that you're doing really well.
Yeah.
What are the next steps? What we can expect from the company in the next 3 to 6 months?
Sure. Happy to provide you with some guidance. So right now we're generating significant interest in the cannabis vertical, both for industrial hemp in mm-hmm. the United States, alongside marijuana and hemp throughout Canada and into Europe and other jurisdictions where it's legal to produce those products.
Mm-hmm.
We anticipate to hopefully close several additional sub-licenses in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
And we're also exploring standalone licenses in those foreign jurisdictions for those products.
Mm-hmm.
We've disclosed that the typical royalty we expect to generate from these deals is between 1 and 2 cents per gram produced.
Mm-hmm.
So looking at our machinery, which we're selling, the introductory continuous line, which is 60 kilowatts, we sell for $1 million USD, and that will generate somewhere in the range of 20 metric tons of finished product, running only an 8-hour shift, 5 days a week, 220 days per year. So that's 200,000 on the low end of royalty generation.
Mm-hmm.
And the beautiful thing about the cannabis market is that the market acceptance has already been achieved.
Mm-hmm.
It's different from a food company who's using our technology to generate new innovative products,
mm-hmm.
where they have to go through, you know, acquisition of distribution, you have to gain consumer acceptance. So it's a bit of a slower uptake,
mm-hmm.
and slower growth of royalty. So that's what really excites us near term. Also, NutraDried Food Company, our subsidiary that's selling the Moon Cheese product, mm-hmm. is doing outstanding. We hired a new CEO to run that business, Mike Pidlinski. He's implementing his plan now, and we've seen month-on-month continued growth with success in Costco's ecosystem. We're going to be launching into Walmart with mm-hmm. a new format quite quickly here, also in Whole Foods and Publix and others. So we look at that business as a key driver of our financial performance
mm-hmm.
over the coming quarters. And then lastly, in the food space, we announced actually this week a new commercial license with Royal Friesland Campina,
mm-hmm.
One of the globe's largest dairy companies, where they purchased a 10 kilowatt unit for placement at their facilities in the Netherlands. And we're looking forward to continuing work with them. And you mentioned the third large scale line recently bought by Milne Fruit Products. I mean, that's mm-hmm. again, a testament that the technology works, it creates value for mm-hmm. its user. And more so, eventually now, the consumers have accepted, embraced their product portfolio. And I think we're gonna see a lot more, call it inflection points with mm-hmm. current food licensees in the coming quarters, being that they've had the machinery for some time, they've spent the money and put forth the necessary effort to build buy-in from the consumers, and companies like Bondwell with their in-flavor mm-hmm. dehydrated frozen product line, Gailey in Canada with their dried cheese snacks, they've been working hard to gain more consumer acceptance. I believe those are the type of companies that could snowball into additional repeat machine orders in the future.
So that's meant, or sounds for me, that it's speed up the revenue stream. Yep. So the, now you're coming up in this area where we say really to scale the business model.
Correct. I mean, so we reported our fiscal 2018 numbers, which were 22.8 million top line and just over 2 million adjusted EBITDA. And for 2017, we had about 16 million in revenue. So we saw good growth there. For fiscal 2019, we're guiding in the range of, call it 35 to 37 million top line. That's a combination of NutraDried growth with Moon Cheese sales, which we're targeting for approximately, call it 20 to 25 million.
Wow.
And then for machine sales, conservatively, call it 10 to 12. And royalties, we'd like to see grow from 1 to approximately 2 million this coming year.
That's huge. So that's mean from 20 to 35, that's a jump of 70%.
That's our target. And thus far, you know,
the projects. And what's mean this on the EBITDA numbers?
Okay, so if you break down the three different revenue streams, that takes you to about between, call it 8 to 10 million EBITDA. If we hit those marks.
Yeah, but last year was around 2 million. So it's really 70 million in 70% in revenue growth, but 300% growth in the EBITDA.
So obviously the different revenue streams have different
EBITDA, for sure.
Right? So for
not only I will make it that I understand it right. Yeah, so okay. It's a big jump.
It is. But I mean, primary growth again would be from 16 million or so for NutraDried last fiscal year to say prospectively 25 million top line for fiscal 2019, which equates to, you know, a 30% EBITDA margin. So call it like seven and a half million EBITDA approximately. And then we have our machine sales, which we have typically, we target a 30% gross margin, but that's not always the case in negotiations. Sometimes that margin's compressed slightly. And then of course royalty is basically pure profit, right?
What is the reason you think that the share performance is not so good that your operating performance?
Well, it's certainly not from a lack of marketing that our management's put forward in the capital markets here. And to be straightforward, the interest in our stock has grown significantly based on performance, right? Building the foundation for future success here. However, we've had a bit of overhang with some ex-employees that have been selling stock for quite some time, and so we're working through that and moving forward. I mean, we can combat that with continued positive news flow, you know, continued announcements that are going to be impactful to our top and bottom lines, and eventually the stock price will catch up to our performance.
Can we expect something new 2019? Don't misunderstand me. I'm really happy with the performance, and I must really say it's unbelievable. I say this many times by my viewers that for me it's unbelievable your operating performance. I'm always a little bit frustrating when I see then the stock performance too.
Yeah.
And I'm happy with your operating performance. But is there maybe possibility of something new?
Well,
something unexpected
new in regards to stock performance or new in terms of operating. Corporate operating
stock performance is not in our hand, you know, but the operating performance is in your hand.
I think what would be new for our business and our operating performance is the prospects for, you know, multiple large scale machine orders from a singular licensee. That's far different. Typically what we've seen in times past is a company adopting the technology through a pilot scale unit and then proving out their business case and justifying the CapEx investment for a larger continuous line or lines. And where we're at now is that we know there's proven business cases for certain product types. There's interest and actual engagement from very large companies that want to move quickly. And specifically in the cannabis space, there are companies that state if they're going to adopt our technology, they want to adopt it throughout their entire ecosystem to ensure that their products are consistent. So, I mean, you can do your own analysis on some of the bigger players in that industry. What does that mean? How many metric tons are they projecting to produce per year? Okay, well, let's reverse calculate how many machines would be required to match up with their production. So that's what really excites us to really drive growth this year. And then longer term, we'll continue to focus on the diversified verticals in which we operate in the food space.
Brayton, thank you for the update. Ja, ich glaube, da brauche ich nicht viel zu sagen. Operative Performance ist wirklich ein Wahnsinn. Ich habe es auch im Starter-Interview, also in der Einführung, in der Einleitung gesagt. Der erste Kunde hat auch schon seine dritte Maschine geordert. Das zeigt wirklich, wie stark das Ganze läuft. Dann Cannabis ist eine Order abgeschlossen worden mit T-God, mit Green Organic Attachment, wo ich auch Aktionär bin. Und da ist es ja besonders spannend, weil dort gibt es auch eine Royalty von 1 bis 2 Cent pro Gramm. Das heißt, jedes Gramm, was die produzieren, läutet bei denen die Kasse und das macht es richtig spannend. Und wenn das dementsprechend so umgesetzt werden kann und gerade Cannabis kann das wirklich stark nach oben gehen, kommt dementsprechend Umsatz. Aber auch so die Planung für 2019 ist extrem spannend. Sie planen für 2019 so 35 bis 37 Millionen Umsatz. 2018 waren es um die 20 Millionen Umsatz. EBITDA war um die 2 Millionen und so erwartet hat um bei 8,5 bis 9 Millionen. Also das heißt ein Riesensprung im EBITDA. Das heißt, ja, das ist um 200-300% höher und das sollte sich dann auch im Aktienkurs abbilden. Wir werden auf einmal eine Phase haben, wo innerhalb von ein paar Monaten die Aktie irrsinnig schnell reagieren wird und dann auf ihren neuen fairen Wert eigentlich hochschnellen wird und da muss man eigentlich dabei sein. Das heißt, ich gehe wieder raus aus diesem Interview und denke mir, ui, ich muss jetzt dort meine Position aufstocken, ich habe nur eine halbe Position und ich muss dort eigentlich schauen, dass ich dort schnellstens auf eine größere Position komme, damit ich diesen Schub, der dann kommen wird, dass ich den nicht verpasse. Und der Grund, warum der Aktienperformance relativ niedrig war, hat er gesagt auch, sie haben alte Mitarbeiter gehabt, die Aktien gehabt haben und die haben eigentlich am Markt diese verkauft und das hat den Markt oder den Aktienkurs relativ gedrückt. Das war's von Enwave, Jänner 2019, Vancouver. Tschüss und Baba.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks.